Oh, man. Oh, man. They let a worship leader up here. What's about to happen? I don't know if that was the right call. Maybe I'm just going to sing opera for an hour. I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen. Well, I'm definitely not going to do that. But here's what I know. I know what I'm supposed to do right now. I have the job that Paul gave Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, where he said, preach the word. All right, my job is to preach the word. To preach means to herald. And the word is right here, and it's in your hands. I hope you have a copy of God's word in your hands, because this is why we have gathered, to hear from God, because these are the very words of God. If I haven't had the privilege of meeting you, my name's Eddie Hoagland. I've been here for 9 years on staff in different roles, and now I have the joy of serving as the lead pastor of worship and production here at Harvest. And it was 9 years ago, and we came in. It was my fiance at the time, Christina, now my wife, and we sat right over there in that section. And we were just blown away at how God is at work here in this church. Couldn't believe the things that we were seeing. Wow, God is so at work here, and we still believe he is at work. And we see it week after week after week, the things that he's doing. And my job here today is not, I'm not like a speech writer for the king, right? Because the speech has been written. My job is to herald the message to you that has already been written. And because the law of the Lord is perfect. This is what Psalm 19 says. God's word is perfect. There's nothing I can do to make this better. You understand that, right? There's nothing I could bring to improve what God has already done. The law of the Lord is perfect, and it revives the soul. It revives the soul, and I don't know about you, but I want that today. I want my soul to be revived. I want to have that sense of newness in my life today, and that is what we're going after today. I want to talk about worship, so no surprise there, right? That's the topic we're going to be talking about today. To worship God means to ascribe worth to him, the things that belong to him. So when we gathered today, we sang songs, we lifted our hands, we gave of our tithes and offerings, and now we're standing under the authority together of God's word. We're doing this together. Why? Because we're ascribing worth to God. We're saying, God, you're worth these things. This is why we do it, because you're worth it. And over the past few months, I've just seen how God's been growing me as a worshiper. I mean, if we would just rewind 6 months and you said, Eddie, here's what the next six months are going to look like, I probably would have been like, yeah, no thanks. Not super excited about that. But this is why God's word is a light unto our path and not unto our destination. You have to understand that God doesn't reveal everything to us, because he's the one who can be trusted with all knowledge, not us. But his word is a light unto your path so that you know what to take, what's the next step. And like I said, the last 6 months have just been hard. I mean, it just has been, not only with what's going on here in our church family, but things in my family, things that have happened to my friends that I'm just telling you, like 2019 has been a year like no other. But God is faithful. God is good. And in my darkest moment when I was, I don't even remember, it was a few months ago, and I was sitting down in our living room, and I was with my wife, Christine, and I was just telling her, I'm like, babe, I don't think I can do this. Like, I don't think I have the strength. I don't think I can do this. And it's a good thing to find a godly wife, because she looked at me and she said, you know what, you're right. You can't do this, okay? But God can do this. And you should not quit just because you think you're not strong enough. Instead, you should spend all that time and rely upon the Lord. And I'm telling you, I have seen, and I stand here as a testimony of God's faithfulness, because he's given me the strength day after day, meeting after meeting, everything that I have to walk through. God has been faithful to give me the strength to be able to do that. And it's been in our times of worship here in this room that God has comforted my soul. And he's granted me the rest that I needed. I know so many of you can relate to that this has just been such a life-giving place for us every single week as we gather. Because in our times of worship, we realize who God is, and we stop thinking about ourselves, and we get a greater glimpse of who he is. So we're going to jump into God's word, but before that, I just want to pray. Would you join me? Father, we thank you so much that we are your children. Who are we that you're even mindful of us? Who are we that you would ever spend a second thinking about us, and yet you do? And you love us so much that you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to this earth to die in our place so that we could now have a relationship with you. God, we're just asking that you would speak to us today, that as we dive into your word, we would hear from you. Holy Spirit, we say we're willing, we're open, we're listening. We're here to hear from you, God. And I just pray that you would help me to be faithful to the message that you have already placed before us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. All God's people said. Amen. All right, so the bulk of the message is actually going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 24, so if you want to turn there right now, that's where we're headed. But the core of why we're going there really is found in Romans chapter 12, which I have on the screen. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says this, "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship." Man, I love this picture, that we would present ourselves as a living sacrifice. What's Paul referring to, right? An altar, a sacrifice. But yet he's using some terminology that we wouldn't have heard before. Living sacrifice. That's actually an oxymoron, right? Because if you're the animal that's going to be placed on the altar for a sacrifice, and then it gets consumed with fire, I'm pretty sure that animal is not alive anymore. But here Paul's charge to us is that we would be a living sacrifice, so that we would have the behavior of what it means to sacrifice, and yet that we would live that out, that we would live it out every day. And then notice what he says, holy, right? Holy and acceptable to God. Holy means to be set apart. We are set apart because of what God has done for us. What makes us holy, what makes us different, is that God has saved us. He has made us his children, and that's what makes us different, right? It's like what Moses said, like, why are we distinct as a people except for the fact that you are with us, God? And that's what makes us holy and pure and blameless, is the things that God has done in our lives. But he doesn't just make you holy, he makes you acceptable to God. What does it mean that you're acceptable to God? Well, it's actually pretty simple, but it's very profound. Acceptable to God, meaning that he receives the things he has requested us to be. So the more things we do that God has asked us to do, the more acceptable it is to him that we would be that living sacrifice. For it is our spiritual worship. So this altar we're talking about, it's not a physical one. It's a spiritual one. Our altar of worship. And that's what I'm going to be talking about here tonight. Building an altar of worship. How do we build an altar of worship? Well, I'm not even an altar building pro myself, so I should probably find someone who is and learn from that person. And again, thankfully, we have everything pertaining to life and godliness right here in this book. And so if we're gonna learn from someone, I actually think we can find that, and that's why we're gonna go to 2 Samuel chapter 24. We're gonna be studying in the last part of the book. So we're gonna start at verse 18, and we're gonna go all the way through the end of the chapter, which actually is the end of the second book of Samuel. And before we are able to even start right there in verse 18, I just gotta give you a little bit of context, right? We gotta know where are we jumping in here. Because it's really important. So the chapter starts with David. Yes, David the shepherd, David and Goliath. You know the guy, right? David the king now, king of Israel. David sins against the Lord by sending Joab to complete a census. And it was sin clearly in the passage because David acknowledges his sin. But I just got to be honest. When I first started studying this passage, I was like, why is that such a big deal? Like to just count the warriors of Israel, like that, to perform that census. Why is that a big deal? Well, there's two reasons I see. One is when God asks you to do something, it's not just about the what, it's also about the how. You have to do it in the right way. And we know that David performed the census not the right way, because in the parallel passage in 1 Chronicles chapter 21, we find out that they actually left out two of the tribes. So it wasn't even done the right way. But more than that, the second reason is I see that David wasn't relying on the Lord. He was acting more like a Near Eastern king would have been acting at the time, right? Counting his warriors and realizing his own strength instead of relying upon the Lord, because he was hearing from God. And if God was going to take him to war, then that means God knew how many warriors he was going to need for that war. And so he sins against God by not relying on him. But then something beautiful and awesome happens. Then David realizes he sinned greatly against the Lord. But this time he realizes this without a prophet. When David sins with Bathsheba, right, Nathan has to rebuke him and has to call him towards repentance. And isn't that beautiful that now we see David, his heart struck him is what the Bible says, that his heart is now realizing he needs to be repentant. David was a great king, not because of all his choices, but he was a great king because he was a repentant king. Saul confessed his sin when he got caught, but David repented. And as he confesses his sin before God, but that still means that judgment is coming. And so the Lord gives David three options for judgment. It could be 3 years of famine, 3 months of being chased by your enemies, 3 days of pestilence, And David is greatly torn. I mean, can you imagine, like, having to pick one of the judgments of the Lord? And he's just completely distressed over what this is. And yet he reveals how he has a heart after God's own heart. And because what he says is he actually chooses to put himself into the Lord's hands instead of into man's hands. So because he knows that God is the one who's merciful, so remove the option of being chased for 3 months by my enemies, because I have found man to not be merciful, but God is merciful. So he gets rid of that option, and then what ends up happening is a pestilence for 3 days, and the angel of the Lord is sent to cast this judgment upon the people of Israel, and 70,000 men die. Who knows how many total it was, but 70,000 men die, and then the angel of the Lord comes up to the border of Jerusalem, so now he's near Jerusalem, and then he pauses right before getting to Jerusalem, and there's this pause, and that's where we start. That's right here where we're jumping in, verse 18, with the tension of that moment that I just described to you. And verse 18 says, "And Gad came that day to David and said to him," so Gad is David's seer, so this is how God communicates with David. Gad says to David, "Go up, raise an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite." So David went up at Gad's word and the Lord, as the Lord commanded, and when Araunah looked down, he saw the king and his servants coming on toward him. And Araunah went out and paid homage to the king with his face to the ground. And Araunah said, "Why has my lord the king come to his servant?" David said, "To buy the threshing floor from you in order to build an altar to the Lord that the plague may be averted from the people." Here's the first step of David building this altar. He is seeking the mercy of God. And as we are trying to learn how to build our altar of worship to God, we are going to try to follow the same pattern, that we would seek the mercy of God. Mercy is when God withholds the things that we deserve. He withholds those things that we actually do deserve. That is God's mercy towards us. And we begin to build our altar with the acknowledging of our need for mercy. You have to have that sense that you need God to withhold the things that you deserve. Why? Because the greater the sense of the need, your need for mercy, the greater our thankfulness to God becomes. I'm so thankful that God is merciful to us. You understand that what we deserve is death. What we deserve is condemnation. And yet God says, "I will withhold that from my people." And instead, he puts that on his son, Jesus Christ. And God is still being merciful to you right now. And if you have turned away from your sin and embraced Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, he's still being merciful to you right now. He's holding that right now as I'm speaking, because he's a merciful God. And the greater you have a sense of that, the greater your thankfulness can be. And then it'll start making sense. Why are we entering his gates with thanksgiving? Well, that's where it all starts. Do you understand how awesome it is that God is merciful towards his people? How awesome it is that we get to take another breath. That is the position of a worshiper. That is where it starts. It's so interesting to compare where we are today in modern day and comparing to Israel, right? They had such a clear sense of this. But again, I mean, they had seen the Red Sea split. They had seen the earth open up and the sons of Korah being swallowed up and all these things. And then you see the judgments of the Lord, and they had a clear sense of their need for God's mercy. And may it be today that as we learn how to build our altar of worship to God, that we would have a sense of how we need his mercy. That we would come into this room week in and week out as it's a worship service. And as we walk through those doors, think, "Man, God is withholding the things I deserve." And that is growing a sense of thankfulness in my heart. So then we move on to verse 22. It says, "Then Araunah said to David, 'Let my lord the king take and offer up what seems good to him. Here are the oxen for the burnt offering and the threshing sledges and the yokes of the oxen for the wood. All this, O king, Araunah gives to the king.' And Araunah said to the king, 'May the Lord your God accept you.'" An interesting little connection right there before with Romans 12, that we would be acceptable, God. "May the Lord your God accept you." And then verse 24, we're going to see David's answer. But just before we jump into that verse, like think about what's happening here, right? Back to where we were. So the angel of the Lord is about to cast this judgment upon Jerusalem, and Araunah offers it for free. He says, you can have the threshing floor, you can have all these materials for the sacrifice that you're going to make to seek the mercy of God. You can have it all in the parallel passage. We also find out he can have the whole piece of land, the site, and he offers it to David for free. But what's interesting about that is David said he was going to buy it. And yet Arana, and I don't know what his motivation was, I just know that if the angel of the Lord is right by Jerusalem and he's bringing a judgment of the Lord of pestilence, it's like, what's the fastest way we can get this done? Like, forget about any money. Like, you can just have it. You can just have this for free. Not only that, I'm going to help you have the things you need for the sacrifice so that it can be done as fast as possible because we need the mercy of God. And yet David says no. David says no. Why does David say no? It's right there in the text, verse 24. But the king said to Arana, no, but I will buy it from you for a price. I will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God that cost me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. I will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God that cost me nothing. I'm not going to do it. You see the heart of David right there. I'm not going to do it. Like, it's right there, it's available to him, and he says, no, I can't do that because I'm not going to offer something to God that costs me nothing. He has a sense of understanding that you don't seek to worship God just like the minimal way, right? The heart of a worshiper is not a heart of minimalism. The heart of a worshiper is not seeking, hey, God, like, what's the bare minimum I have to do to actually count as worshiping you? That's not the heart of a worshiper. It's the opposite. You're seeking, what more can I do? What more can I do? Because the heart of a worshiper is not a heart of minimalism. And worship calls you beyond the threshold of your personal preference. So what that means is as you stand there and imagine a circle around you, and here are the things that if you were to reach and obtain, you would say, this is my personal preference. So this is kind of the space I would like to be involved in. These are the things I like doing. These are the things I don't like doing. All those things, that's your personal preference. Put it in there. Worship actually calls you beyond that. That once you get past the things you'd like, you start focusing on what would God like? What would God ask of me? And that's where it starts becoming what we want it to be, which is my second point, which is we should give of ourselves sacrificially. Give of yourself sacrificially. Why do you think the temperature of our worship services has been going up the past few months? I mean, I can't tell you the amount of times I've talked to someone after a service or even during the week in small groups, and everyone's just like, man, I don't know what's going on, but the worship, like the Lord's doing something. And why do you think it is that the temperature of our service is going up? Well, I would like to suggest to you, maybe it's because it's costing us more. Maybe it's because it's harder to sing now than it was before. I know it's true for me. It's a little bit harder to get up on stage right now and to say, yeah, I'm going to keep doing my job and staying faithful to the calling that God has placed before me. And I have seen time and time again that as the cost of what we're doing has increased, God has blessed it even more. Because we will not offer things to God that cost us nothing. We're not seeking to have the most convenient way to worship God. We're not seeking to have the fastest way like David could have had with the giving of the threshing floor. That's not what we're seeking. And so what are the ways that shows up in our worship services? Well, I think it's pretty clear, right? If we're going to offer something that costs us something, well, then we probably should show up with enough time to be able to get into the room to worship God, you know? And I get it. We got two kids, 6 and 4, so it's a lot of work. And sometimes, you know, with my wife, we serve at the Crystal Lake campus, and we got to get up at like 5 a.m. and get the kids ready and then get up to rehearsal. And I get it. It's work. It's a lot of work, but that's okay if I understand that it's part of my worship to God, that it's okay that it's a sacrifice, and it's okay that I'm getting up earlier on Sunday than any other day. Why? Because I'm going to worship God, and I want to get here with enough time to get my kids checked in and Harvest Kids, and that I can be in this room to offer my sacrifice of praise to God because he's worthy of that. And so I get it here early, and I focus my heart on him, and not only that, but I don't want to leave early either, right? And I get it. I mean, it is inconvenient. I've been to this campus a bunch of times. Sometimes we finish service and then you get over there and you're just like sitting in line to just get out of the property, and it takes a little bit of extra time, and you set your reservation for dinner at like 6:32 for some reason, you know, whatever reason that you like gotta go, gotta get out of here. And I get it, it is an inconvenience, but I'm just suggesting to you, it's okay. It's okay that it costs you something, because this is what we're bringing to the Lord. It's not about the people on stage. It's not about any one of us. It's not about any of you. It's about God and our offering of worship that we want to bring to him, that we are not willing to give to him if it costs us nothing. So I want to hand you 5 offerings of sacrificial worship. Here are just 5, and there's many more, of course. But here are the 5 that I just felt led to walk you through. 5 offerings of sacrificial worship as we are building our altar of worship to the Lord, our spiritual worship. The first one is singing. Psalm 96, verse 1 says, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth." The word sing right there is the word shir, which is just means to sing, and easy to understand. But notice it says, "Sing to the Lord all the earth." So the stipulation for you to be the one that this verse applies to would be, do you live on planet Earth? And I think we all qualify as we live on planet Earth, and this is what the Lord's saying. He wants you to sing to him. God wants you to sing to him. You know, I grew up in Mexico City, Mexico. My dad's a pastor there, and I started leading worship when I was 15 years old. And I was not at all ready, I would say. Musically ready, maybe. Leadership-wise, not quite there yet. And we didn't even have someone who was supposed to, like, help me learn the things about worship. It was just kind of like, you kind of play guitar. Go. It's your turn. Like, go for it. You're the worship leader of the church. And this was big church, you know, not like youth group or something like that. And so I'm 15 years old. I'm trying to lead worship, and there's so many things I did wrong. But the Lord taught me many things by doing the wrong thing. And so one of the things that I was unwise is I just thought very plainly, and I was up there leading worship, and I would look out, right, like I'm looking at you, and I saw one of my friends, and I was like, he's not singing. Like, why is he not singing? I know what I should do. I should go talk to him about that. And the reason it's unwise is because if that's what worship leaders were doing, that would make everyone feel like they're about to get judged every single service, and that's not what we're after here, so don't worry. We don't do that. You don't have to worry about that. But me, as an unwise 15-year-old worship leader, I go up to my friend, and he was my friend, so I guess there was a little leeway there, and I tell him, hey, I was like, hey, man, how come you don't sing in church? Like, what's your deal? And his answer was, well, ultimately, it's just, I just don't like it. Like, it's just not me, right? And he had a very clear limit or a threshold of what his personal preference would be. But it got even more interesting. We kind of left it at that, but it got really more interesting when we went to a concert together, and then he just starts singing his face off for his favorite band. And then we go to a birthday party together, and he's singing happy birthday to that kid, his nephew. Like, he has no problem singing there. And that's where it got really interesting, because that's where we realized that you got to go past your threshold of personal preference. And instead of thinking about, am I willing, think about, does God want me to? It's a beautiful thing that the Lord of the universe would like to hear you sing. And he doesn't say anything about the quality of your singing. It doesn't matter at all. It doesn't matter to the Lord. For sure doesn't matter to the team, just so you know, the worship team. All we want to do is we want to be leading you to do the things that God wants you to do. And he wants you to sing. This is what God wants. The second offering you can bring him is shouting. Psalm 66, verse 1 says, "Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise." That's the word ruah or ruah. I'll let you in on a little trick. So since I'm from Mexico, I speak Spanish, and anytime I have to say a word in Hebrew, I just say it with my Spanish accent. It makes people think I know what I'm talking about. So it's the word ruah. Yeah, that sounds a little bit more Hebrew. And that just means to cry out greatly, to split the ears with sound. Man, I'm not even exactly sure what that means, but it just sounds pretty powerful. To raise the war cry, to cheer, to shout in triumph. To shout in triumph, this is what God says. And shout for joy to God, who? All the earth. Can't get out of it. Can't get out of it, sorry. God knows you. God knows where you grew up. God knows where you came from, and yet he still wants this from you. He knows all those things, and yet he still wants this from you. And I get it. I mean, we have all different kinds of families. I grew up in a family, I don't know, if you came around our dinner table, we call it talking, and you might be like, that's shouting. Like, that does not qualify as talking. And then on the other side of the spectrum, you got families that, like, I mean, they're just so soft-spoken. And I've been, you know, you're around the dinner table, you're going to pray for the meal, and I can hear the sizzle of the food louder than the prayer that's being whispered somewhere else. You know, it's like, they're so quiet, everything's so reserved. And that's okay, there's nothing wrong with being that kind of family. But here's what the point is regardless of what your background is, God still wants you to shout. And you don't have to shout anywhere else, but in the praise of God, may it be that you would reach your maximum volume, that you would even reach the point that you're shouting, but not just shouting for no reason, shout for joy to God, a shout of triumph. Do you understand that if you have Jesus, you win? Like, you win, no matter what else you could lose in this world, it does not matter if we have Jesus, amen. That's right, now we're getting there. If we have Jesus Christ, we win. And so when we're shouting, we're not shouting in response to anything earthly. We're actually shouting in response to something heavenly, that God's kingdom is coming and is here because he is king and he is Lord. That's what should make you want to shout. And that's our second response, our second offering. Don't get ahead of me now, all right? All right, the next one is clapping. So our next offering of sacrificial worship is clapping. Psalm 47:1 says, clap your hands. All peoples, clap your hands. Shout, hey, there we go. Amen. And then it says it again, shout to God with loud songs of joy. The word clap right there is the word taka. It just means to strike your hands together. The root of the word is, it comes from a blast of a trumpet. So if the trumpet just went boom, and that's what we're doing, but we're doing it with our hands. Boom, right? We're clapping, and that's what it means, taka. Clap your hands, all peoples. And, you know, I grew up in a church where, again, my dad's a pastor. He never preached on, like, you're not allowed to clap. Like, he never said anything like that. And no one ever from the stage said, like, no clapping allowed. But, I mean, if you stand in the church, you're kind of like, yeah, we definitely don't clap here. You know, like, it just never happened. It just never did. And we never clapped in a song, at the end of a song, like, nothing. We clapped to welcome guests, but that was about it. And so that's the kind of church I grew up in. And again, here I am as 15-year-old worship leader trying to figure things out. And I'm leading one weekend at church, and I have the youth choir behind me, and we're singing, this is in, like, I don't know, somewhere in the early 2000s. And we're singing, you remember that song, we wanna see Jesus lifted high, a banner that flies. Well, I'm not getting a lot of response, but maybe you don't know it. But in the chorus it goes, we wanna see. Okay, there's like three people. That's good. Anyways, in the chorus, you're supposed to go, we want to see, we want to see. Okay, a lot of things have changed since the early 2000s. We don't coordinate our clapping as much these days. But there was this song, and so there we are, we're singing, queremos a Cristo pro. And I have the choir behind me, and I know it's coming. I'm like, here's the first time we're going to clap in church. And I'm so nervous. I'm telling you, we're singing the verse, and I'm just start sweating. So sweating bullets. I'm like, what's about to happen? And I was so consumed with what are the people of the church going to do? Like, I don't know. Are they just going to bolt out the back? Like, what is going on here? Again, unwise worship leadership, because the right way of doing that is actually to do this, to teach people that this is something that God wants. Because if you don't teach people that it's something that God wants, then they think it's a fad or they think it has to do with your generation. It does not. This has nothing to do with a generation. It has everything to do with the things that God has asked of us. And I've seen time and time again that the more we do the things that God has asked, the more he blesses that. And he doesn't bless a style of music. He doesn't bless a band. He blesses his word. And the more and more as a church that we give God the things he's asking for, you just see what God's going to do. We really don't know what he could do if we were to just give him everything he's asking for. And the next offering of worship would be dancing. Oh, now it got controversial in the room. Everyone's like, oh, hey, I'm fine with singing, shouting, whatever. But hey, easy, easy. Slow down, Eddie. Like, we can't talk about dancing. Well, here's just so you know what I'm trying to do here. I would only like to talk about dancing as much as the Lord talks about dancing. And I just want to bring to you the message from the Lord, because Psalm 149:3 says, let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with the tambourine and lyre. And maybe the tense of that verse is a little misleading to you, like, let them praise his name, like it's a permission thing. Like, if you're one of those dancers, maybe we should, like, have you behind that curtain, and that's like the dancers section, you know? It's not that kind of let them. It's more like, may it be so, let it be that his name is praised with dancing. That word is machol, to twist or whirl, to dance, including physical movements of various sorts, a joyful trembling in worship. I love that. There's motion to it. Now, notice it's physical movements of various sorts, so it's not like there's like a version of the Macarena that God's like, that's worship, you know? It's not like he didn't give us something very specific in that way. It's just movements of various sorts that the worship would get to the place where there's motion. It's not just like feet here and here alone, right? That there would be motion. A lot of times when you're studying a word in the Hebrew, getting back to the root of the word and seeing what other words are connected to the root is actually very informative. And that's very helpful to me in this word, because the word machol, the root in a negative way, means writhing in pain, writhing as with pain. And it even references like child labor, right? Birthing pains. And writhing in pain for, you know, a non-baby making kind of person like myself, writhing in pain for me is like when I stub my toe. And, you know, and I always think of like when we, you know, we moved here 9 years ago and we bought this IKEA bed here in Schaumburg. And IKEA's pretty great. You spend, I don't know, $250, you get this bed, and then you spend about 8 hours of a workday assembling said bed. And then you spend 2 hours going back in the steps to catch up to the step that you messed up about an hour ago to fix that, because it turns out I'm not super great at following Swedish pictures of things, of like how to assemble this. I prefer words, personally. But and then you finally get to have a bed. Then I look at the bed, and I'm like, yeah, that looks super cool. But for some reason in my brain, like the IKEA bed, I'm like, I don't know where it starts. I don't know where it ends. All I know is I think I sleep there, you know? And so I'm walking towards the bed, and I just don't know where it starts or ends. And so then I just hit my toe, and I stub my toe right on the edge of it. And then people have different responses to that. I've seen people, like, when they stub their toe, they just start running in circles. Like, it's just like they're just running in circles. For me, I'm a little bit more introverted, so I kind of stub my toe, and then I'm like, ugh, and I enter into the fetal position. I'm in so much pain, but, like, I am in so much pain. There's so much pain in my body. It's not just like my toe. It's like everything about me is just pain, pain. That the pain is so great that I cannot stay still. The pain is so great that I cannot stay still. And could it be that the joy of the Lord would get to be so great inside of your heart that you just can't stay still? That as you think about the goodness of God and as you remind yourself of the goodness of God, you just can't help it. And as you're worshiping, it's not just this. Sometimes it's like, man, I'm walking a little bit. And there's another word in the Hebrew that says it's a lot. And that just means jumping, that there's that jumping sense of like, I just can't stay still. Not because of me, not because I care about the people around me. It's about what God has done in my life. That's what's spurring me on to move. That's what's making me do this. And if God wants it, I want to give it to him. I want to give that to him. And the last offering of sacrificial worship that we're going to talk about today is raising of hands. Psalm 143, verse 6 says, I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you like a parched land. Selah. That's the word paras, to spread out or stretch over. Like a parched land. It's an expression of need, clearly, right? Within that psalm. And maybe you're there. Maybe you're in that parched land. And you could express your sense of need of God by stretching out your hands and just say, God, I need you. But it's not just that. There's another psalm that actually says, lift up your hands to the holy place and bless the Lord. So it doesn't just have to be need. You could just be saying, God, I just want to bless you. Like, this is why I'm raising my hands. And you can guess if I grew up in a church that didn't have clapping, there wasn't much raising of hands in my church either. And so I'd never raised my hands until I went to college in 2006, that would have been. And I go to Liberty University, and I'm going to get a worship degree because God called me to ministry. And I start reading God's word, and I just realize, man, it's there. Like, it's there. It's not that God's okay with it. It's that God wants it. Like, God desires this. And so I said, well, I'm not feeling it, but I want to obey him. And so I just make the choice, and I go to one of my classes because it's a worship program. So we would sing, and they would lead us in worship at the beginning of one of our classes. And so I sat in the back row. You better believe I sat in the back row. And And then they start leading us in worship, and I'm just telling you, I never felt anything specific. I didn't know when it was supposed to be, if there is a when, there's not. I just was trying to figure out the rules, and I stood there in the back of that classroom, and without feeling it or anything, I just went, okay, here we go. And the hands are up. And it wasn't, like I said, it wasn't anything special in the sense of my experience, but it was deeply special to me in the sense of my obedience to God. And I sensed the Lord delighting over it, not because of my experience, but just the willingness to sacrifice my preference, the willingness to go beyond what I would choose to do within my personality and to give God the things he is asking for. And so that gets us to the last verse of this passage, last verse of the book, verse 25, and the last point of this message is that we get to see the response of the Lord. Verse 25 says, "And David built there an altar to the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord responded to the plea for the land, and the plague was averted from Israel." See the response of the Lord to someone who sought his mercy, to someone who gave of themselves sacrificially. And then the Lord responded, and a plague was averted. And if you are a child of God here sitting tonight, a plague has been averted for you as well. You have experienced that same thing, that a plague has been averted. And as we build our altar of worship, as we do the things that we've talked about here tonight, we want to see the Lord respond. But you need to know, you don't get to decide how the Lord responds. You leave the outcome to the Lord. So it's not like I'm giving sacrificially. I want to do these things because I'm somehow in this transactional relationship with God that I know he will do this specifically. You don't get to decide that. But you get to decide if you're going to bring your offering of worship. That's the choice you have. And you can leave the outcome to the Lord. And I just got to share with you, when I spent time this week studying this, I just didn't realize the significance of what I was studying. But then I did. That this is the purchasing of the threshing floor. That King David is buying it from Arana. And this very same piece of property is the same piece of property, same piece of land that Abraham took Isaac up, because God told him to offer up Isaac, and then a substitution is given. And then this becomes the place where the sacrifice is offered for the atonement of sins, a temporary sacrifice, always looking to Jesus Christ, who will be the permanent sacrifice for our sins. And this threshing floor is the Temple Mount. It's the same place where David would now gather up the materials and his son Solomon would build this temple and the glory of the Lord would dwell there. The same city where Jesus would come, and where he would be crucified. Sometimes it's pretty easy to just let the Old Testament feel so distant, right? You just feel like, well, that's kind of then, and I get that. There's Levitical law, ceremonial law that we don't observe today. But there's a lot we have in common. Because you need to know that today we worship God with a priest. And we worship God not just with a priest, but with a high priest. And we worship God here tonight, not just with a high priest, but with a great high priest. Hebrews chapter 4 says, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." We worship today with a high priest, and we worship today with a sacrifice that was offered to God. It was Jesus himself. Just like John the Baptist, when he saw him, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." So as we seek to build our altar of worship to God, we seek his mercy, We give of ourselves sacrificially. And then we get to see the response of the Lord. Romans 12:1. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, and I appeal to you, Harvest Bible Chapel, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And so the question is, how can you grow as a worshiper? How could you grow as a sacrificial worshiper? Because here's the thing, if you heard a voice as I was preaching and you heard a voice saying, you know what, you're just bad at worship. Like, it's just not you, you're just a bad worshiper. Don't listen to that voice. Listen to the voice that showed you and said, hey, you could probably grow in this area. You could probably do that. And I don't mean to overwhelm you with things you should or shouldn't be doing. What I'm actually trying to get you to is just to have a sense of like, man, I just want to pick this one step. And that's it. I'm just going to say, God, give me the opportunity to grow in this one area. And I want to, and I will be obedient in that one thing. And you, I mean, it's Father's Day week. And you think a father would look down upon a child who's trying to learn how to walk and trip. And that he would look down upon that child with harshness? God's your father. He wants you to grow. He wants you to do these things. And your desire to just say, hey, I'm going to start growing, that would be awesome tonight. So with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I just want to give you a moment to decide, where is it that you think God is calling you to grow as a sacrificial worshiper? That you need to change from desiring that cheap worship, that free opportunity, and going beyond that to a place of offering God something sacrificially. And just tell that to God right now. Just say, God, I want to grow with this. I'll do it, God. I'll do it. Father, we know that your word does not return void. And for everything we have heard from your word, we believe you will use. God, help us to grow. None of us have arrived. We have so much to learn, so much to still grow in. We are thankful for your presence and for what you've done. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. All God's people said, amen. Let's stand up and worship the Lord now.